भारत कोरोना से लड़ेगा भी और आगे जीतेगा भी, आगे बढ़ेगा भी। भारत इस बड़ी आपदा को आपदा समझ करके रोते बैठने के पक्ष का नहीं है। भारत आपदा कितनी ही बड़ी क्यों न हो, उसको अवसर में बदलने के लिए कृत संकल्प है और हम सब मिलकर के आपदा को अवसर में बदलेंगे। कोरोना के इस संकट ने भारत को आत्मनिर्भर भारत, सेल्फ रिलायंट होने का सबक भी दिया है।
Going back to the international front on China and India, you just mentioned that the administration is monitoring the situation, but the president has mentioned that he would be willing to mediate the conflict between China and India now. If he were to do so, what does that look like? Does that look like a one-on-one conversation? Does that mean bringing the two leaders together? Has the president indicated what mediation looks like for China and India?
So again, no formal plans on that beyond what I already said and expressing our absolute condolences to the Indian soldiers that died as a result of today's confrontation. We extend our deepest condolences there. And I would note just that during the phone call on June 2nd of this year that President Trump had with Prime Minister Modi, they did discuss the situation on the India-China border.
I'm obviously delighted that India has got into the Security Council with tremendous support. And I'd like to express my gratitude to the member states of the United Nations for this ringing endorsement. Our election is a recognition of Prime Minister Modi's global role. His strong engagement across countries and across regions has clearly found resonance. It is also the result of a very strong campaign which has been led by the Honorable Minister of External Affairs, Dr. S. Jaishankar. It also reflects the strength of India's bilateral relations with member states of the United Nations. You know, there is widespread concern on the inadequacies of the multilateral institutions to meet new challenges or to deliver results. And our priorities seek to address these concerns. India has very strong developmental credentials, and I think this will help us in our agenda on development and peace. And we have also been at the forefront of advocating issues relating to traditional and non-traditional security threats.
Thank you. Will India participate in the RIC summit on 23rd June? Aishwarya from AP has asked, is the RIC meeting still going ahead as planned? There were comments from the Russian side yesterday. Would be grateful for a confirmation from our end as well.
See, the Russia, India, China foreign ministers meeting is scheduled on 23rd June. Russia is the chair this year. Russia has called for a special session of the RIC meeting to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the victory in the Second World War over Nazism and creation of the United Nations. It will be the first meeting of the RIC foreign ministers, which will be taking place through video conferencing. EM will be participating in this meeting. The agenda, as someone has asked, the three ministers are expected to discuss the current situation of the global pandemic and the challenges of global security, financial stability, and RIC cooperation in that context. And this is going to be a trilateral meeting.
What is the importance of being a non-permanent member of the UN Security Council? Does it or will it help in becoming a permanent member?
Well, you know, the UN Security Council is the highest body that the international community accepts, charged with the maintenance of international peace and security. Our presence on the Security Council and our performance there over the next 2 years will underscore the value that a country like India brings to the table and reaffirm our credentials to be a permanent member of the UN Security Council. It will be a good measure of the value India can bring to the Council by increasing the representativeness of the Council and building bridges among various groups. It will help the process of making the Council better reflective of contemporary realities. We will, of course, continue to take part in the intergovernmental negotiations in the UN where the matter of UN Security Council reform is being discussed, and we will make efforts for concrete progress in those negotiations.
गलवान घाटी खास तौर से इंडो चाइना बॉर्डर में जो घटना हुई है, निश्चित रूप से ये बहुत ही पीड़ाजनक है और उन 20 शहीद जवानों को मैं अपनी श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करता हूँ। गणेश कुंजाम जो छत्तीसगढ़ का बेटा है, कांकेर का रहने वाला है, उनकी शहादत निश्चित रूप से छत्तीसगढ़ ने अपनी शहादत देश के लिए दी और पूरा छत्तीसगढ़ उस पर गर्व करता है। मैं इन सभी को अपनी विनम्र श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करता हूँ। जहाँ तक सवाल है कि चीन की इस कायरतापूर्ण कार्रवाई का जवाब के बारे में विपक्ष जिस प्रकार प्रश्न कर रहा है, मुझे लगता है कि राहुल गांधी या सोनिया जी को इस विषय को लेकर देश के सेना के द्वारा उठाए गए कदम के बारे में कोई प्रश्न करना नहीं चाहिए। आज समय इस बात का नहीं है कि वहाँ पे उपस्थित सेना के अधिकारियों ने क्या निर्णय लिया। सवाल इस बात का है कि हमारे जवान यदि शहीद हुए हैं तो उन्होंने भी चीन के सैनिकों को काफ़ी बड़ी संख्या में न केवल हताहत किया है बल्कि बड़ी संख्या में उनकी भी मौत हुई है। तो हमारी शहादत बेकार नहीं जाएगी। जैसे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा है कि हम मजबूती के साथ भारत इस सारी बातों का जवाब देगा।
But I'm sure all of you have seen the news of the elections which took place on the 17th of June to the United Nations Security Council. India was elected with overwhelming support, garnering 184 votes out of 192 to become a non-permanent member of the UN Security Council for the term 2021-2022. India was elected unopposed, as we were the sole candidate for the Asia-Pacific seat. However, this was made possible because Afghanistan had withdrawn in our favor in 2013, for which we thank the government of Afghanistan. The strong support by the entire UN membership for India's election demonstrates the goodwill that India enjoys in the UN and the confidence that the international community has reposed in India's capability to contribute to the work of the Council.
Overwhelming support for India at the UNSC elections, but there are some reports in PAC media that after endorsing India last year in Asia-Pacific group, they would not vote for India in the final round. Is that correct? Was there any statement from Pakistan permanent representative, because the ballot is a secret one? And if this were the case, do you believe they have politicized the matter by bringing in bilateral relations in a multilateral platform?
You know, unfortunately, this is the kind of behavior we have now been seeing from Pakistan over the past many, many months and years. They always rake up bilateral issues in multilateral forum. In fact, they have made it almost as a standard norm for their policy. As far as we are concerned, our foreign policy has a much broader canvas. We have a much wider and global focus. And as a member of the UN Security Council, we will be dealing with all those issues which are under the consideration of the Security Council, in line with the priorities that Honorable External Affairs Minister has already outlined.
Pranay Upadhyay from ABP News and Neeraj Kumar from News 18 have asked for an update on the meeting between India and Pakistan on the locust management.
I had briefed you last week on the developments in this context. And you would recall that in May 2020, we had taken the initiative to call for intensifying contacts between locust warning organizations of the two countries. And these contacts have been taking place over the last 60 years. We thought it was important in wake of the threat posed by desert locust. And we even proposed to Pakistan coordinated locust control operations. And we also proposed that we can facilitate the supply of pesticide for locust control operations. In fact, we have already delivered 20,000 liters of Malathion pesticide to Iran for desert locust operations in their territory. As per available information, Pakistan side has refused to join this meeting. And this meeting was proposed to be held today. We find it unfortunate that Pakistan maintains its reticent attitude even when its own people face the threat of food security. And we will continue to coordinate with FAO in this matter.
Within 125 days, nearly 25 schemes of the government are all going to be brought together. And within those 125 days, we shall reach saturation levels for each of those schemes. So if it was a Jal Jeevan mission, or if it was anything to do with laying of Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, or building Awas Yojana, and so on. Awas Yojana, which gives houses for the poor, but if there are activities related to that which requires labor component, they will also be brought. Like that, there are 25 works of Government of India in which all the 25 being brought together for those districts where we have identified this number of Shramik who have gone back. Everyone who needs the assignment will be given the jobs, and under the 25 different works, the objectives which have to be achieved will be achieved using the shramik who are there having returned from different parts of the country. The monies which have been allotted to these projects, budgeted amounts, and if necessary anything more, will all be added together. At the moment, broad total that I can disclose to you all, it's about 50,000 crores. We are pooling all these from the 25 different projects, bringing it together so that at the district level, in these 116 districts, for those 25 projects, shramik who have returned will all be used to complete those projects within this 125 days. There are some which are going to get affected by monsoon, such as laying of roads, which may extend further. There are some which are post-monsoon activities, which may also continue after that. But largely, on a broad indicator, we want to front-load the monies allotted for these 25 different works. For those 116 districts, some of whom are aspirational districts, and ensure that all those shramik in those districts are going to be given employment, and therefore, for them, for the next 4 months, we are clearly showing a direction through which their skills, their man days, person days will be used so that assets will be created in those districts.
India wants peace, but it is capable to give a befitting reply if instigated.
Is this said to China, or is this said for effect within India? These are not the words that you use if you want to find a solution. It's these kind of words that might have provoked China to do what it's doing. So I would be very careful about what I say, but be that as it may, it's his responsibility. He has to deliver peace, or he has to deliver whatever else he wants to deliver. But we are only there to say we will support so long as a legitimate path is taken and a sensible path is taken in dealing with China.